Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Hopefully you can hear me all right. What a great plenary talk from Mauricio. Thank you very much for that. We're going to go straight into the next session, and then there's a coffee break at 3:30 until 4. So it's my honour and privilege to introduce the OR Society's President's Medal competition for this year. The President's Medal is one of the Society's most prestigious awards, and it's awarded for the best practical application of OR submitted to the competition. And we use a wide definition of OR in this award, and entries are welcomed from both industry-based practitioners, consultants, as well as from academics and government. And there's various criteria which we assess and judge the President's Medal entries on. I'd like to introduce our decision panel today for the President's Medal. So as well as myself, Seb Hargreaves, the Executive Director of the Society, the President's Medal is also reviewed by our current president, Gilbert Owusu, president of the OR Society, who is also data and AI director at BT. We've also got Dr. Heather Tewkesbury, who's helping us as well today. And Heather's the previous CEO of the Smith Institute and has just taken on the role of Director of Strategic Partnerships, I think that's right, at the Smith Institute. And we've also got John Hopes, who many of you will know is a past president of the OR Society. He is also secretary of the Heads of OR and Analytics Forum. The criteria that we use to judge the winner of the President's Medal, it's judged across five criteria. Firstly, the level of demonstrable benefit and impact. Secondly, innovation and creativity. Thirdly, the likely longevity of the solution. Fourthly, excellence of the OR process. And finally, the intellectual and novel content of the solution. Now, you'll be pleased to know that we invite some audience participation in this part of the program. And so we've got some of our student volunteers are handing out some voting forms for you. Which are fairly straightforward. The instructions are on there. You'll be listening to three presentations in succession. I'll be introducing each one as they come forward. There'll be an opportunity at the end of each presentation for both the panel first to ask some questions of the presenter. And then if we have time, we can take a few questions from the audience as well. At the end of the session, once you've marked your voting forms and when you're leaving the lecture theatre, please just hand those back in to the student volunteers who will be by the doors collecting those in for you. So thank you. So delighted to introduce the first speaker, if he's here. I think he is, yes. So the first entry, which was shortlisted, was from the HMRC's AI Assurance team. I'm delighted to introduce Shaquille Khan from that team, who will be talking about generating value by mitigating AI risks using the AI Assurance Toolkit. So, Shaquille, it's over to you.
The slides.
Yes.
Oh. There's a clicker here. Just move it forward.
Okay. Brilliant.
You don't need this?
Okay. Right. Thank you so much for inviting me today to present. And today's presentation is really explaining the journey that we've had in HMRC and across government and beyond, actually, to develop an AI assurance toolkit. For many, many years, organizations have aspired to develop and deliver AI in a safe, trusted manner. And I think the community that this initiative has managed to bring together is absolutely incredible, and it's been a real privilege over the last 20 years to be a part of that group. So, you know, what I'll describe today is 100 organizations contributing to this assurance toolkit both at HMRC and beyond. I particularly like to basically thank the latest editorial team to the guidance back at HMRC as well. So, you know, AI touches every aspect of our life, from banking, government, predicting health outcomes regarding diagnosis and prognosis of illnesses. Back at HMRC, we're big users of AI, both in the compliance context and also in the customer service context as well. So I think my job has been even more challenging given the advent of generative AI and ChatGPT as well. So how can we make sure that all these different applications of AI are indeed trustworthy? And, you know, the statistics that were produced by the Department for Digital Culture, Media and Sport was suggesting 432,000 UK companies adopting AI in some form with expenditure of 16.7 billion. And that's expected to rise exponentially over the coming years. And, you know, particularly you know, across the board, not just in the public sector, but in the private sector as well, we see AI systems or algorithmic systems failing and really creating catastrophic problems. You know, we heard about the exams algorithm and what that did to GCSE and A-level students. Facial recognition, we understand about the challenges in terms of trying to understand different skin tones and interpreting those types of challenges. And interestingly, in the Dutch tax system, they used algorithms to decide which benefit claimants were fraudulent or not. And in fact, that was quite disastrous in the sense that they ended up splitting families as a result of an algorithm. And in fact, the Prime Minister and the government had to resign as a result. So AI risks, how they manifest themselves is quite concerning, really. And I think technologies such as generative AI go into the psyche of individuals as well. So that's another layer of concern. So we really need to understand how we validate and assure AI, and that's what we've been trying to do at HMRC and with our partners. And, you know, this is very topical, not least the Prime Minister has brought together experts, or will be bringing together experts for the AI Safety Summit in November. And in 2021, there was a paper from Cabinet Office promoting the concept of AI assurance ecosystem, whereby organizations are created to service and test to make sure that AI systems are indeed safe. So I think, you know, this all comes back to the concept of trust. Before we deploy AI systems, how do we know that they're doing what we want them to do? And, you know, that we need to demonstrate to both internal colleagues and also to our customers that that what we're delivering is indeed trustworthy. So we understand concepts of trust on an individual basis, but in terms of organizations, what are the key features that will enable trust with our key stakeholders? And we kind of summarize them under three tenets. One, is the AI relevant to the problem within the organization, or indeed to the individual? Is it ethically aligned with our values? And thirdly, is it technically robust? So these are the tenets on which we develop our AI assurance system. And the mechanism by which we do this is a series of checklists. And, you know, when we talk about checklists, there's a lot of, snobbery, you could call it, say, how could a checklist actually have any impact on, you know, what experts do? So Atul Gawande, a famous surgeon at Harvard, ran a trial with 8 hospitals from urban centers right to rural communities in Africa. And basically the surgeons were adopting these series of checklists, but there was massive resistance because they felt it was an insult to their expertise. But in fact, what their results found was quite phenomenal after the end of this pilot. They found that mortality rates across these hospitals reduced by 47%, and that far exceeds any medical advancement. So really, you know, demonstrating the power of the humble checklist. And that's the actual core of what we're trying to do within our work at HMRC and beyond with our partners. You know, checklists, what they allow us to do is build that trustworthiness. We have evidence then to our various stakeholders to say, actually, you know, here is a consistent way of checking. We've checked across many different AI systems, and, you know, we can demonstrate that you can trust what we do. Of course, all we can do through these mechanisms is manage risk. We can't eliminate the risk, but, you know, through my experience, the adoption of these methodologies is really far-reaching. So HMRC, what do we do? Her Majesty's Revenue and Customs, we are the UK's tax service, and we basically collect the money that pays for our hospitals, schools, policing. The list goes on and on. And you know, the numbers that we're talking about are quite staggering. 814 billion collected between 2022 and 2023. Just our non-compliance avoidance evasion activities bring in an additional 34 billion, and that's an aspect where machine learning has great contribution. So, you know, what's really important is to try and understand what principles do we adhere to at HMRC, and, you know, what we're trying to do is make sure that the right tax is paid. We're trying to follow the Civil Service Code, the Equalities Act. But in the age of an AI-assisted world, we need to go one step further, and that's why these checklists are very important. And what we're trying to do is probe back to those three tenets. Is the system that's being commissioned going to fit the problem that our internal customers are trying to address? And that can be quite challenging. If we don't get the right description at the start, then what we describe is a fail-fast concept. So if the AI system isn't going to fit the problem, then we just need to stop there. So, you know, trying to formulate the problem is very important indeed. And then, you know, issues such as debugging, making sure that the data is representative of the population that you're going to apply the AI to, these are all fundamental to our checklists. And that stands on a foundation of ethical standards. There's been a lot of debate about whether ethical standards are enough, and I think certainly in the arena, there's been a drive more towards trustworthy and responsible AI, you know, incorporating ethical standards, but going beyond that, as I described in my three tenets. And then simply back at HMRC, you know, what we're trying to do in terms of some of this machine learning methodology is target high-risk taxpayers. So, you know, you may find, and these statistics are representative of some of the uplift of models that I've seen in various organizations that I've assisted, fiscal organizations. So you may find that rule-based systems, expert-based systems, manage to detect 25% fraud rate. When you move towards a predictive technology, you can really get an uplift up to 80%, and I'll give you an example of that in the real-world environment. So part of my role over the several years has been to support other fiscal authorities in building capability in machine learning as well. And I was leading a three-year program in Pakistan from 2018 onwards. And They basically, we started from a basically zero near zero capability in machine learning, and within the space of 3 years, the team was created, and they were delivering machine learning. And in terms of importations, they managed to improve their detection rates from 33% to 76%, and their head of analytics regarded our AI assurance standards as integral to how they deliver and ensure quality in their machine learning. So that was absolutely amazing to see some of the successes there. And going back to the life cycle of delivery of AI, our checklists and our rating systems, they live throughout the development and the deployment and the maintenance of these systems. But indeed, in terms of the scoping of these technologies, we embrace OR. In fact, operational research community and government were the initiators of these assurance standards. So we're very proud to be growing this all the time. But definitely, bringing in influence diagrams, multi-criteria decision analysis, you know, not just within HMRC, but within partner organizations as well, really championing what we do in OR to better facilitate the implementation of AI. I think it's a partnership made in heaven. So moving on, another part of the life stage of delivery is the model building stage. And, you know, we have various challenges, you know, also depending on the environment as well. You know, how do we know that the variables that we're feeding into our models are robust enough for what we're trying to predict? You know, is the population relevant? These are all the forms of tests that these checklists prescribe. And indeed, you know, like I say, going back to the surgeon example, some analysts would turn their nose up to say, oh, we know all of this anyway, we don't need to do this. But one of the team leaders of these machine learning developments described his take on the assurance standards, and he explained that it inspired checking to go beyond what they would normally do. So that's absolutely fantastic. And again, during COVID, there was serious population drift to our models. And what the assurance standard allowed us to do was go back to a kind of prescribed methodology of checking, which was developed by machine learning developers within the department and with our collaborators across government. And checking statistics such as score versus odds, making sure that the variables haven't been overly affected, such as turnover, by COVID. And considering the types of machine learning that we want to apply, are opaque systems such as random forests and boosted trees still applicable and still useful, or do we need more transparent methodologies so that we can pull out variables that are showing instability? So all this learning has really been assisted by the Validate AI initiative as well, and I'll talk a little bit about that too. So in HMRC, what are we doing next? I mean, AI assurance is a hot topic now, and we're really pleased that we've identified and nurtured this guidance over the last 20 years, and we see still that this field of quality, making sure there's quality in AI, is very much, one of my colleagues describes, the elevator at ground level. So there's so much more to do. And what we're trying to do at HMRC to make our work more accessible is create power apps or automation so that the checking can be then brought together in a central database, and we can identify gaps and better iterate the checks that so that they're relevant to the latest advancements in AI, indeed in terms of generative AI, which is the hot topic at the moment. And making sure that what we do do is aligned to UK AI strategy as well. So I mentioned as in my role as AI capability building lead at HMRC, really embracing what's going out in the wider community in industry and academia. And I was attending a Royal Society event in 2018, whereby some of the academics there, particularly from Oxford and Imperial College, were concerned, were celebrating the accessibility of machine learning through open source, but really concerned that the genie was kind of out of the bottle, and that ease of access was allowing models to be deployed that were not really as robust as they should be. So Validate AI was born as a community interest company at the Royal Society in 2019, and we've had absolutely fantastic engagement from industry, academia, and government. And what we try to do is bring together experts, not just from the analytical community, but from other professions that are really concerned about how AI is validated. Lawyers, ethicists, engineers, the list goes on. And what we're trying to do, particularly over the coming year, is pick at different aspects of the challenge of AI assurance and certification. And we're delivering a roadshow. It actually started last week at Edinburgh University. And each university is hosting a different challenge. It may be a sectoral challenge. It may be a particular challenge within deploying AI. So the particular problem at Edinburgh University was saying, okay, if you procure AI, what is it that the customer and the supplier need to do as partners to make sure that what they are delivering is indeed trustworthy? And that was a very lively debate. And, you know, hopefully we will have some guidance coming out of that workshop over the coming months. And there's another workshop at the British Computing Society. We're really proud to be allied with other learned societies, particularly grateful to the OR societies for their immense support for this initiative as well. And I'm really excited about the University of Southampton workshop, which is delving into how operational research particularly can really boost trust in delivering AI methods. And, you know, just coming back to the main aspect of this award and what was being considered, I think, you know, AI risks, the issue is when you're developing risk management systems, it's not obvious about what benefits that they can bring. But, you know, what we do see is if AI systems do go wrong, as the examples I gave you, it can have catastrophic effects both at a country level and at an individual level as well. And this AI assurance system has been about gathering tacit knowledge from the wider community, and that's what makes this so usable as well. It's because the people who are using the assurance system are the actual authors of the system as well. And, you know, I'm really proud to say that Validate AI particularly has allowed a wider community to join this conversation and help develop the guidance for the future. And, you know, being studying operational research at university and being a great advocate, it's great to see how soft OR and hard OR, particularly when I go on international capacity building and they're not aware of OR techniques, how that's then being embedded, and how you know, developing countries are really excited about how multi-criteria decision analysis and influence diagrams can really help shape what they do. And, you know, the portfolio of tools really does embrace OR as well. And, you know, there's stories about how we've used simulation methods as well. But on that note, I'll stop there.
Shaquille. Firstly, are there any questions from the panel at all? That Gilbert? Or yeah, question from Gilbert.
Thank you very much, Shaquille. Just a quick question. In terms of enforcing the use of the checklist, any thoughts on that, please?
I mean, that's a really great question. And more recently, a lot of people have said, oh, look, AI is going to be regulated. We need to get onto this. But, you know, our journey started 20 years ago. I think what is really concerning is the risks that companies are exposing themselves to. So it makes very good corporate sense and reputational sense to adopt it as a risk management tool and not consider it just as a legislative protective tool. So,
hi, Shaquille. I was just going to ask you about how you keep this methodology current, because it's a rapidly changing area.
Yeah.
You know, you mentioned that, new technology coming along all the time.
Yeah.
Have you thought about that, how you build that into the checklist?
I mean, methodology is evolving all the time, and the roadshow, actually, if you show the roadshow slide, that demonstrates that we're not complacent. We're really constantly evolving the guidance and the principles, and we're embracing the wider community to make sure what we do propose is reflecting the most recent. I mean, the Imperial College deep dive is on generative AI, so that's one aspect of AI. One thing that I am concerned about is generative AI steals the show, and there's many other applications of narrow AI that get neglected, and you know that's something that validates AI we don't want to happen.
Yeah. Thanks, Shaquille. I did want to ask you about generative AI and what your thoughts are on where it's going with government, with HMRC. If you could stargaze, what do you think will happen?
I mean, the thing is, obviously, there's great promise with the technology, but within government, we want to be incredibly cautious about how we use that. So assurance, guidelines, principles are something that we're working on, and you know that's like number one on the agenda. So
yeah, and I had another question, if I'm allowed, which is about you mentioned making sure data is representative. I see there's, you know, potential conflict there with generative AI if it's searching very widely about how representative you can be with that.
Yeah. I mean, I think when we were thinking about assurance in narrow AI applications, it was quite straightforward. The issue with generative AI is, it's, you know, the results are not, you know, it's kind of following a stochastic process. So they're not repeated. It's not the same result. So to try and assure generative AI is incredibly challenging indeed. So I think it's just something that we need to consider very seriously and think about how we actually adopt it and, you know, not rush into it. Think about which applications are best to use it in the first place.
Great. Thanks, Shaquille. We haven't got any time now for any questions from the audience, but I know Shaquille, as all the speakers, will be here over the coffee break later. So if anyone has any questions for them in the coffee break, then you'll have an opportunity to do that. I'm going to just blank the screen, and we'll just in a moment we'll get up the next presentation. Thanks. Let me pop the sound up a bit. Is it the microphone, this one, we can maybe increase?
Okay. Hey, I put it up now.
Thanks. Okay, so the second presentation this afternoon is from the Department for Energy Security and Net Zero. Delighted to introduce Adam McKenzie-Jones from the department, who's going to talk about the work on the Net Zero Systems Tool.
Cool.
Thank you, Adam.
Thank you. Just check this. Does that work?
That won't work because...
It won't work. So I need to use this. Is that okay? Okay, cool. Yeah, so thanks for the intro. Yeah, my name's Adam McKenzie-Jones. I head up the Net Zero Systems team. In the new Department for Energy Security Net Zero, I think we've been around about 6 months now, so probably not that new, really. A few thank yous here. I'm very, very grateful to be shortlisted here, and thanks for your attention, but also thanks to all these people on this slide here. I'm going to use the word we a lot, and when I say that, you have to imagine these people. They're faceless people, I suppose, to you, but there's a lot of people behind the scenes here, and I'm kind of the... summarising all of their hard work. So I'm going to talk to you a bit about our work in the net zero policy world, and specifically my kind of small analytical team. I'm looking to bring in systems approaches. So I'm sure many of you are aware the UK has got a target of reaching net zero emissions by 2050. I'm sure many of you are aware that that is a complex challenge. It requires a complete transformation of a lot of our socioeconomic systems. And I suppose this is me being humble as a government official. Historically, public policymakers have probably tended to layer individual policies on top of one another. And when doing that, you risk creating perverse outcomes. You're not necessarily... treating root causes, you tend to be looking more at symptoms. The more robust approach would be considering the different parts of net zero, energy, transport, industry, greenhouse gas removals, as parts of an interconnected system. And, you know, I speak to a lot of people about this all the time in work, in my day-to-day life, and it seems like a bit of a no-brainer, but actually we have to very actively think about how our things interconnect. When you're working across very large organisations, obviously those silos emerge, those bits of communication become harder. And in January 2020, the Council for Science and Technology wrote to the Prime Minister to strongly recommend the adoption of a systems approach that did focus on those interconnections. So January 2020, that was Patrick Vallance there writing to the Prime Minister. They spoke to each other quite a lot in the months after that, not necessarily always about systems thinking for net zero. But the Prime Minister did agree that that should be a priority, and that broadly led to the setup of our team. And we quickly developed a clear vision for what the team should be looking to achieve. And broadly, it's about bringing systems approaches and sort of prioritising that interconnectivity into government's approach to delivering net zero. But we're very much seeing that as a cultural change. That government needs to fundamentally change the way it's approaching complex problems, but specifically net zero. And we've set ourselves three, what we think are three clear missions. There's a sort of, at the heart of it, and probably what I'm going to be talking about with today is mostly focused around this, although it does cut across all of them, is the collaborative mission, and that's about making sure that the different parts of net zero, the officials throughout that policy landscape, are considering themselves as part of an interconnected whole. There's a learning organisation mission, which I sometimes call the kind of the humility mission, which is about kind of embedding a culture of reflection, continuous learning, monitoring and evaluation, making sure we haven't just got it solved because it felt like that was the right solution, bringing in systemic theories of change. And then there's a strategic mission that makes sure that we're focusing on the right things at the right time. And so what I'm going to talk to you today is about a tool that we developed to support this vision. There's a wider program of work, but this is one part of it. Treasury runs a shared outcomes fund, and they funded us to develop this tool. And at a high level, it was developed to kind of inform users of the wider impacts of any policy decisions they make in the net zero space, identify sort of further opportunities for collaboration and learning from each other, and also prioritising the need for further analysis and research. And to ensure effectiveness of that tool, it needed to be underpinned by a clear set of systems thinking principles. We worked very closely with the Government Office for Science on the Systems Thinking Journey and Toolkit, which you can find published on gov.uk. And that set out a very clear underpinning of what a systems thinking approach was. And we also needed the support of a wide infrastructure across government. So many of you may be aware of the Government Systems Thinking Interest Group, STIG, which I helped set up, which now has over 700 members, and is really about developing awareness and capability across government. We also developed a systems thinking college, which was about giving people an introduction to systems thinking and to get them started on a systems thinking journey and giving them some of the core principles so they could sort of build from there. And we also saw a very key part of this challenge is the role of leadership. We need that sort of top-down sort of steer of, you know, I've got this business case. Where's the systems thinking in that? How is this investment in the energy world affecting industry, etc.? And we came up across a few challenges along the way. One of the challenges, and I guess I've already kind of alluded to it in the fact that, you know, the natural occurrence of silos in large organisations, we were working across departmental boundaries when we're delivering net zero, and there's a risk there of unaligned objectives and a lack of join-up. So we very proactively have set up a cross-departmental team. This structure isn't very common in government, but what we've got here is something that cuts across those three core departments that are focusing on net zero. So the Energy Security Net Zero Department, DEFRA, and DFT. We've got systems leads for five different systems across net zero. We've got buildings, energy, and industry in my department, and we've got transport and land use in DFT and DEFRA, respectively. And those people are responsible for embedding systems approaches and the tool that I'm going to share with you today. Into those policy areas. They're embedded into those policy areas, and they've got big sign-off from DD level, director level, senior civil servants. One of our big challenges is in bringing something that was going to communicate the interconnectivity of net zero to people was the challenge of kind of static systems maps. So obviously developing things like causal loop diagrams is a really great way to kind of surface mental models and get to a consensus of sorts. But they can end up being a little plate of spaghetti, as my friend from the FT described one of our maps that was published in the Net Zero Strategy. I'm on board with what he's saying there is that, well, how can I use this map of electric vehicles? We want to be able to repurpose this and use this in government activity. And one of the solutions that we've come up to this is to create something that can. A platform where you can interact with systems maps, ask the map questions, and interrogate it really. What's the story behind this? And one of the inspirations, this was something called Loopy, which is like a website. You can just Google it and have a look. But it helps you interact with systems maps. One of our other challenges with systems maps is that quite often in government we develop them through workshops, mostly with policy officials, with strategy people working on strategy, and we don't bring in sort of the external, a wider external view, and we risk having quite a narrow perspective of what is quite a complex system. So when we developed our maps that underpin the Net Zero Systems tool, we brought in a wide stakeholder landscape that included academics, subject matter experts from industry as well, and we iteratively developed the maps. You can see them getting more and more like a plate of spaghetti there, I suppose, and they were validated by academics at the end there. One of our other challenges was that the focus in the net zero world tends to be more on the hard technological systems and less on the soft, complex systems, focusing on sort of people and behaviours. And there's also quite a bit of focus on sort of carbon counting, effectively. So there's a lot of pressure to fully quantify our maps. But the risk of that is that we risk sort of false precision, oversimplification, and sort of, you know, that false precision is really there's a compound uncertainty with those sort of systems maps there. Will you also risk ignoring the unquantifiable elements in the maps? I'll leave you to Google the McNamara fallacy, but you can see we've done a data review of external consultants of what percentage of our maps we could quantify, and there's a big percentage that we can't quantify, and we don't want to miss that part of the story out. And in tackling that, we looked at a few potential options for quantification. One of those was to develop link magnitudes between the system's maps, so weak, medium, strong relationships, and sort of flow those through and multiply those together, and they'll dilute over time, but give a sense of the strength of the relationships between variables, but also probably more innovatively linking to existing models. So our existing models are great, but they're probably missing some of the stuff that's in our system's maps. And we're working now to bring our systems maps together to help design new scenarios and also drive further bespoke analysis. We also, I'm talking about a culture change and wanting to a wide range of people in government to use the tool. That's quite a challenge in terms of design of something. So we had to be very careful, especially things like causal loop diagrams, to not make them something that's too technical and too tricky to understand. So with every kind of round of agile development that we took with the tool, we brought in a lot of user testing. We also brought in expertise externally from systems experts. So I'm talking a lot about the tool, and you probably want to see the tool, and I want to show you the tool. Bear with me. I do have to switch. It's sort of, you see, right, okay. Right. So this is the tool here, and you can see I mentioned we've got systems leads for each of these five systems. Each behind each one of these, there is a systems map, and they're all interconnected with each other as well. So I can click into, for example, the land use map, and it brings out that map there. And you can say, well, you said we were going to try and avoid the plate of spaghetti. I'm going to show you a few ways of how we're going to try and avoid doing that. So one of the things we can do is we can look at just livestock in land use, for example, and we can draw kind of a more focused map around that. I can also look at specific variables. So I can look at UK livestock numbers, and I can double-click on that, and I can just look at some of the key interactions there. I can also click on this target button, and I can look at all of the levers that I have around upstream in order to affect that variable, and I can also draw out little theories of change there. One last thing, I don't want to spend too long on this, but I can look at specific variables. Actually, I need to reset here. I can look at specific variables. So in this land use map, I can look at, for example, UK meat and dairy production. So this is not government policy, but we could look at potentially decreasing UK meat and dairy production in terms of the net zero strategy. And I can click on the lower half of that variable there, and it flows through the wider map. So the way the tool shows you the impacts is if something's got smaller, the circle gets smaller. If the variable's got larger, the circle gets larger. It's still very difficult to pick through that. You do have to sort of search through what the wider impacts are, but you can show changes as a list, and that's been something that's been very popular with users. And you can see here, there's little insights here. So, manure that you get from livestock is a potential use of anaerobic digestion feedstock availability. So you can see that's going down there. And if I just pan over to here, I mentioned about the maps being interconnected, so that anaerobic digestion feedstock availability ends up affecting sort of what you're doing with biomass over in the energy map. So I won't go over that particularly, but I just want to show to you that there's a link there across those sectors that could risk being silos, essentially. So I'll leave that there, and then I think that's going to start it from the beginning, which is, bear with me. So we've got kind of a wide range of impacts and benefits from the tool. We've conducted two evaluations of the project, and they've sort of brought out that the tool uniquely provides cross-cutting support to officials to consider the wider system impacts. It's a new way to explore complexity and uncertainty for people. We've established what I think is quite a unique cross-government systems team that's working across the net zero challenge. But we've also created a new sort of innovative go-to capability for systems mapping in government. So the code that runs that tool that you've seen there, we've put that on GitHub. That can be used. It's not a net zero bit of code. It can be used for any policy problem, and it's been used across government, and we're sharing that with more and more people each month. We've got as many as 400 monthly visitors to the Net Zero Systems tool, which we're quite proud of. That shows that there's an active user base using the tool. We're also feeding into the key publications around net zero. So we fed into the Net Zero Strategy, this year's Powering Up Britain Net Zero Growth Plan, and we will also be feeding into the upcoming Land Use Policy Framework from DEFRA. We're also building into departmental appraisal guidance, so the development of business cases. And there's a lot of kind of sort of ad hoc use of the tool across the net zero sectors. So, for example, there's a development of a heat networks strategy at the moment, and that'll be that's being massively informed by the use of the tool. But we have been successful with getting further funding for another couple of financial years. We're feeding into how we design spending reviews, budgets. A key thing is kind of the commissioning of further analysis of research. So that tool you see there is not the end point of the analysis. It's the start point. It's the bit that says you might want to start thinking about this thing over here. It doesn't give you the answer. It makes you think I might need the answer to this. We're also feeding into delivery reporting and risk management, that sort of thing. But we've shared this with kind of across all of the senior, the most senior voices across net zeros. So that's, you know, permanent secretaries, directors general. We've got strong support from all of them. We've also got support from all of the relevant chief scientific advisors. You can read the quotes there. And those are all the very senior people, but we've also got strong testimonies from people on the ground who are using the tool in lots of different ways, in some ways that we didn't necessarily imagine in the first instance. I'll broadly leave it there. Our next steps is really about bringing this more and more into the kind of the structure of how we deliver net zero. I'll probably leave it there. But thanks for your attention, and welcome any questions.
Thank you, Adam. Thank you for your time. From the panel, any questions? Go to Heather first.
Thank you. Thanks very much. Really interesting to hear about all of that. Your last slide was really about, you know, what happens next, and that was going to be the basis of my question, really. So you've got another couple of financial years of funding. Let's say you get to that point in 2 years' time, and you look back and you say, actually, I'm really proud of this thing. So it's more than just the tool. It's about the sort of what policy impacts or, you know, net zero targets do you think you will be looking back on in a couple of years' time and feeling really proud about?
I think it's about getting it into the kind of the very sort of the structure of how we're approaching net zero. So I mentioned things like spending reviews. Some of those sort of mechanics of government can operate in quite a siloed way that mean we don't get to the most optimum solutions. I think it's things like we're talking to the Treasury's Green Book team about making sure that the appraisal guidance that is used across all government investment has got a systems thinking annex there and is encouraging the use of things like the Net Zero Systems tool. So for me, I think it's about making sure that our processes, there's no sort of specific kind of outcome that I want to see. It's that we're doing the right processes and we're considering the wider picture, basically. And we can see, we've got a range of case studies there where we can see that activity is happening. And that, to be honest, you know, it's a bit of a cringeworthy classic thing to say, but actually, probably the best thing is that my team doesn't need to inject that energy anymore. It's just there, and it's just itself perpetuating that culture.
Thank you very much, Adam. Policy evolves, governments have ideas. How would you account for any changes in policy going forward? And if you were to start all over again, what would you do differently?
Okay, so on that, on the kind of evolving goals, I think one of the key things that we set out in the systems thinking journey guidance is to be very clear on what your goal is and what you're trying to achieve, and build your policy from that kind of where you are and where you want to be, that creative tension that Peter Senge talks about in the fifth discipline. It is a tricky thing about implementing systems thinking government, that we have five-year parliaments and that focus changes. And in some senses, we sometimes don't go on quite that right path. But I think actually net zero is a unique challenge in that respect, in that every single parliament from now is going to have to think about net zero. And so whilst the smaller policies might change, that the end goal is going to be the same. And on those smaller policies changing, I'm hopeful. I'm, energised by the fact that when I talk about making sure that our processes are good, I want our processes to enable that kind of, that the small policy changes we make don't disrupt anything else, or we minimise that disruption that is made by kind of sort of U-turns in policy, and we understand what the wider impacts could be. In terms of if I do something differently again, I think a key thing is kind of probably, we've set up that systems team that cuts across departmental lines. We set that up probably halfway through the programme. I would have set that up right at the very start and got that sort of clear sort of objectives and sort of work goals earlier on in the process. That would have saved a bit of time probably.
Hi, Adam. Thanks very much for the presentation. And I guess I have a two-part question. One is, I can see that there's a very clear process you've been through to develop the tool, including building all those maps that then support the analysis that users can carry out. But how did you validate and verify that, the underlying maps in the tool? And secondly, I know you've got funding going forwards. Presumably part of that is around keeping it current, because the world is going to change over the next few years as we go through.
Yeah, so that's a constant process. We're setting up processes whereby kind of every 6 months or so we're running past the map past our analytical boards, and we've got strong relationships through developing the maps with subject matter experts, academics, that we can sort of test those ideas with. In terms of kind of verification, validation, I really feel like the sort of the QA of systems maps is really through iteration, and there isn't, I guess one of the things that we're quite proud of with the tool is that it's not definitive at any point about what the answer is. No, a policy official can't take something from it and run off and put it into a submission. It's very difficult for it to, the way it's formatted for them to do that. So we think there's less risk there, but we really feel that iterative process gets us closer and closer to a stronger and stronger model, and that's really for engaging for as many people as possible and testing it as much as possible.
Great. Thanks, Adam. Again, we don't have time for questions from the audience, but I'm sure you're happy to stay around during the coffee break if anyone wants to come and approach you. Let me get it back on. So just
taking this off. Thank you. Yeah, probably.
So we've got one more presentation before we break for coffee. Last but certainly not least, I'm delighted to welcome Cliff. We'll just get the slides back up. Yeah, there we go. Great. So I'm delighted to introduce Cliff Williams. Who's again part of HMRC, but this time part of the COVID compliance team at HMRC, and going to talk about error and fraud in the COVID-19 support schemes. Cliff, good to see you.
Good to see you, thank you very much. See if this works. Brilliant. Great to be here. Let's crack on with this, I think. So I'm going to talk about, I'll give you an overview about the COVID schemes, just to remind you, it's been a little bit of time. I know we like to try and forget about the whole COVID thing. Then I'm going to talk about some challenges with COVID error and fraud. That's effectively what my team is trying to do. And this is an OR conference, so I'd like to talk about some OR techniques as well that we used in anger. And finally, I'll do a quick summary, a bit of a sales pitch to the judges, I think. So, overview. There were three schemes that we were involved in. First one was for self-employed. Second one was for the job retention scheme, most people call it the furlough scheme. And then there was the Eat Out to Help Out. I won't really be, I've mentioned it here, but I won't really cover it that much. It was only a little bit of the spend. What about the spend? So what we were talking about was about £97 billion across both schemes in 18 months. That was taxpayers' money. £70 billion went on CGRS, £27 billion on SAYS. So that impacted 11 million jobs, 1.3 million businesses, 2.9 million self-employed people. It was absolutely essential to keep people living during the pandemic. And when we're talking about those big numbers, it was at a very, very difficult time for everyone. There was a lot of public interest, and because it was a public interest, we had media interest. And because we had media interest, of course, we had parliamentary interest. How would these schemes work in practice? And how are we going to protect that spend of taxpayers' money? How are we going to make sure it went to the right people? How are we going to make sure that people weren't going to game the system or get it wrong or just plain simply try and fraud the system? With all that pressure, it did really affect exactly how we went about things. We knew that National Audit Office and the ONS, the Office of National Statistics, were going to conduct thorough audits. They were going to look at how we did it. They're going to look at the methodology. They were going to look where we got that data from. And they were going to look at our assumptions, because it was a new system, very new to everyone, and we had to make assumptions. There's assumptions in most models. We also had to think about sensitivity analysis as well, because certain things within the schemes were going to be more sensitive than others to error and fraud. And we also had to think about just how robust our model was, and so we decided to make sure we had a reproducible analytical pipeline. And because of all that audit, because of all the scrutiny, we had lots and lots of documentation. I'll touch upon the documentation later. And it was kind of also related to assurance. Both of our previous speakers have talked about assurance, and we had seven levels of assurance, which included a very, very intensive National Audit Office audit. Quick reminder of the COVID timelines. One of the complexities was the COVID schemes were were only ever designed at the beginning to last a couple of months. No one knew that the pandemic was going to be lasting so long. And so as time developed, so did the schemes themselves. In CGRS, there were three distinct periods in which the level of the grants differed, and there were all kinds of parameters which changed in there. And the same for the self-employed grants as well. There were actually five distinct areas as well. And that meant that when it came to looking at error and fraud, we had to make sure we actually defined what error was and what fraud was. And so that came down to the policy. And we had to use a lot of information from across HMRC, put all our heads together to think about what error and fraud was in these circumstances. There's three main categories that we can talk about. We've got organised crime, talk about criminal gangs. There's opportunistic fraud, this is where people just having a go to game the system, if you like. And then there's legitimate error, where people just make mistakes, fill it, put a wrong number in a box. There were challenges, of course. It was fast-paced. It was changing all the time. Trying to estimate how much error and fraud in that system was very difficult because the schemes were changing, people's attitudes were changing, people's behaviours were changing. We'd never implemented anything like this, ever. So there was no historical information that we could go back to and say, oh, we did this 50 years ago and this is what happened then. There was always going to be conflicts because of the scale and speed of the implementation. And the compliance activity across the population, it was very difficult to establish exactly what the compliance was going to be in terms of behaviours. So, the biggest challenges, I think, for us was really bringing together a lot of different techniques because there were so many elements that we had to take into consideration. Not just one technique would sort it out. And we had to really fall heavily back on OR. We also had to realise, because we'd never done it before, we had to start engaging more. I mean, that included even speaking to the Australian Tax Authority. It was a couple of strange meetings by Zoom. Rest assured, it wasn't a visit. And we also spoke to the University of Liverpool's Institute of Risk and Uncertainty to help us as well. So I'm going to talk now about a few of these OR methods that we've used. We use clustering algorithms. And so we had a data set built for clustering the inputs with claim data, return data, you see the rest up there. And that helped us, get us an algorithm that builds clusters, identify potential organised crime. We can then get a sample from various levels. We could segment them and take samples of those, and we could actually create a feedback loop because we'd want to make sure our experts in the field, our fraud experts, would actually check those claims and see if the algorithm was raising the amount of hits that we were getting. And we used binomial sampling of detection, non-detection, to estimate error and fraud for that organised crime. And we were using unsupervised machine learning algorithm with k-means clustering for the techies amongst you. We also looked at model fitting. This was about identifying customers whose claim profile doesn't really match their tax return. So effectively, we could actually model what we were expecting to see in terms of those claims that people would make compared to what the tax returns that they would be doing. And so you can see there, we've got a little, it's not really following the curve there. It's not following the model. They were, in fact, the ones that we wanted to say, we think these are high risk. One of our standard methods of establishing a population of error and fraud is to use a random inquiry program. And this is, in effect, dip sampling. So we randomly take claims, and then we'll get our caseworkers to work through them and tell us if there was elements of error and fraud within those. And it helps establish a base. The issue with random inquiry programs is that there's always an element in which we might not actually detect something. We call it non-detection, and we have to develop non-detection multipliers. We used a lot of bootstrapping. So bootstrapping, effectively, problem with you, take your random samples, your dip testing. We can't do that many. I've already talked about 11 million people who needed to claim. We can't test. Even a small sample of that will be in its millions, in its hundreds of thousands. And the amount of cases that we could actually test was very low. And so, and that gave us an issue because we got low numbers. And so one way to combat that is to use the bootstrapping method. And it's effectively, we can take that original sample and then we can get our computer programs, our algorithms to resample that thousands and thousands of times, and that helps us establish a safer number, if you like, and gives us a distribution in which we can look at the most likely number. When it came to combining all the risks, I think in CJRS there was something like 13 separate identifiable risks which could be grouped into those three risks that talk about organised crime, opportunistic and error. And each of those we had to consider different types of modelling. And the same for SAES, there was lots of different categories. And so for SAES, I've got a few up there. We got the clustering, we tried the filtering, we got the care fitting. We had to forecast, of course, and there was a macro analysis as well. In CJRS, we definitely simulated a lot when it came to the non-detection multipliers, bootstrapping many times. Survey analysis, let's not forget surveys and analysis of those surveys. Modelling and Delphi analysis, which proved very useful because a lot of those risks could overlap. So what we had to do was actually use a Monte Carlo on both of those schemes and then combine them, and that gives us a final error and fraud figure. So the main output, was that table there. But there was a lot of interest in it because it represents a lot of money. You can see there, $98 billion in spend, net cost. 4.6% was the error and fraud figure that the team created in the end. But that represents about £4 billion. Those figures throughout those 18 months had to go through the iteration through the different models all the time. And each time it ended up with the Chancellor, HMT policy, and all those people. And we have published our methodology on .gov, and it's also in the annual report of accounts as well. There was a lot of interest from the Parliamentary Accounts Committee, and we had to prepare packs for our seniors to be questioned. And I think it was two packs, I remember. So, summary. He looked at the clock. So, I'll talk about the numbers again. 97 billion, 11 million jobs, 1.3 million businesses, 2.9 million. Self-employed. It's a lot of people who are affected by this. When we were doing our error and fraud figures, it wasn't just a paper exercise. It wasn't funny money. Effectively, there was lots of different iterations of different schemes. And our work with our model helped shape those schemes. And what we ended up with was because of that input from the error and fraud. Effectively, if the error and fraud was too high, then the ministers were just not interested. So we used a wide variety of OR techniques. I've only touched on a few. lots of cross-government engagement, and of course, external agencies as well. The quality assurance was so intense, and the third party in scrutiny was a bit overwhelming at times. But at the end of the day, we're the only country in the world to publish such detailed figures. Not just the figures in that one table I showed you, but the methodology as well. We also produced a 350-page technical methodology paper as well. Everything was done in R, and the markdown helped with that, I must say. But nevertheless, we really, really, really tried to be totally transparent in what we were doing. And I would like to talk about, quickly, soft OR, in as much as it was just... all the hard OR stuff is so much fun to do, but just as important was the soft OR. Trying to create those maps so that we could explain to people at different levels how we got those figures and why they should believe them and why it should affect policy and why it should affect exactly what the people got in the end was really, really important. And we had to work so hard at that. And that stakeholder engagement, the managing of that project, I just don't think sometimes soft OR gets the recognition it deserves. However, we did get there in the end. It was a team effort, and I think we helped. So there we go. Thank you.
Thank you, Cliff. That was a really interesting talk. A couple of quick questions from the panel, and then we'll wrap up, if that's okay.
Hi, Cliff. Thanks very much for that. I think what I'm a little bit confused about was, were you just producing the numbers after the event in order to report in the way you said, or is the work actually in some way influencing decision-making, policy-making, etc., and if so, how?
So, it's a great question. Sorry I didn't make it clearer. So, 18-month period, right at the beginning, they needed something. They needed a figure. And there were different, honestly, there were so many different forms these various schemes took. One of the deciding factors was that error and fraud element. The complexity developed over time as we got more and more data. The analysis was helped because we got more data as it went through. It shaped and formed throughout the whole period.
Thank you very much, Cliff. Following up from John's question, we do read from the press that there are still fraudulent claims. Okay. My question is the model still being used? And what else? I mean, are you looking at exploiting it elsewhere?
First of all, yes, the elements of the model are still being used. We've also done a playbook in case anything like COVID ever happens again, the pandemic happens again, so that can be opened and people can just make their lives easier and get on with it quicker. We're learning from this time. But also, there were certain elements I touched upon, NDM, which is our non-detection multiplier. So we developed a way of simulating behavior, not from just the public, but also from our caseworkers. And in that way, we could then clash that against our algorithms and see how good we are at finding fraud. And that helps us establish, when matched with our random sampling, can help us establish how much we're missing. That's got a lot of interest throughout the department and other departments. In fact, we've got a meeting on Friday to talk at the department through on how to do that. So people are also very interested in how we did everything in R and collaborated on GitHub and stuff like that. So there's lots of elements from this that have got a lot of interest, yeah.
Thanks, Cliff. So was I right to read about 760 million of the 4.5 billion was reclaimed already? Did I see that in the table or imagine it?
Yes, you did. You've got good eye for detail.
So I suppose I was wondering whether the methods you developed helped in the triage of cases so that the fraud investigators know which ones to prioritise. Or, is there anything around that in the operational use?
It was very interconnected. My director is the knowledge and analysis and intelligence team. And we work very much hand-in-hand with those experts. And certainly when it comes down to developing those algorithms that identify the high-risk claims. And so, for example, for that random sampling, we required two levels, low risk and high risk, and so we helped develop those algorithms to identify those high risk so we could stratify. Sorry, getting a bit technical now. Is it okay?
Thanks very much. Thank you again to all our entries, particularly our shortlisted entries and the presentations we've heard today. Just a quick reminder as you leave to hand your voting slips in, but I'll just hand over to our president just to say a few words at close. Gilbert.
Thank you very much, sir. Very three interesting submissions. Thank you to all the presenters. Thank you to all the presenters. I mean, this again, a clear showcase of impact of OR, and hopefully we'll be seeing more of these in the following year as we celebrate our 75th anniversary. Thank you very much.